to learn to break systems. You have to learn to break free from familiar patterns. You have to learn to be a little bit less predictable.
You will regret saying that.
Na 20 jaar lang het Tibetaans boeddhisme te hebben beoefend, besefte ik dat alle grote lama's die ik tegenkwam mannen waren. Ze spraken over hun vrouwelijke leraren, maar we zagen er nooit een. Tot in de jaren 90, toen ik Dzogchen Khanro Rinpoche ontmoette. Ik was zeer geraakt door haar. Haar geest was scherp als een scheermes, haar discipline streng en haar hart open voor ons allemaal. Khanro is hoofd van het Samtense Retraite Centrum in India, dat zij op zeer jonge leeftijd oprichtte. Toen haar vader minderling Trichen, een vooraanstaande Tibetaanse meester, overleed, werd ze ook de spirituele opvolger van zijn klooster in Dehradun. In deze film onderzoek ik hoe de wereld kan profiteren van vrouwelijke rolmodellen in het boeddhisme, om ons volledige potentieel als mens te ontwikkelen.
My earliest memory is of my sister. I asked my mother, you know, I remember something like this, is it correct? And she said, oh yes, we used to have a certain window like that. My memory is of her going walking to school, and I have just a vague memory of seeing this person go by, and I really wanted to follow her. And there was a certain type of window that I remember trying to hold and stand on. And I asked my mother, and my mother said, yes, that's her going to school, you know, and you used to always look out of the window.
As a woman, she, for me, is a fearless example of, yes, you know, we were both born women, but, you know, how do we overcome any sense that there's any problem with that?
What she said is that if you're Buddhist 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
When I first encountered her, I think it was a bit of shaking up in myself and a bit of awe and finding myself kind of tongue-twisted in front of someone. But being around a teacher, it kind of wakes you up in a different way, or was suddenly reflecting things inside myself.
My profession is to be a physician in a small hospital in Berlin. It's still something I was really looking forward to, see a female teacher. And it was really nice atmosphere. It was, the room was totally packed, and I think nearly everybody was older than her even, you know? And then she was a woman, she was like 26 years old. And but after like 3 sentences, everybody was impressed and silent. Yeah.
I had started to hear about this young woman who was teaching in English. And one of the things that I think is most important about contemporary Buddhism, one of the greatest needs, is for there to be women teachers, because historically Buddhism has been taught 99%+ by men.
I feel she's one of the most important teachers in the West now at this time. I mean, without a doubt, I think she's going to have one of the biggest impacts that we'll see. I really feel that. They always say that there's this pillars of, like, to create a sangha, there's study, practice, and service. And the kind of those are the 3 pillars of a practitioner. And I feel she's takes the greatest care and pains to instill that in her students in a really balanced way.
A very good evening, everyone. And how are you all? Good? I had the opportunity of earlier meeting with some of you, including the administrative staff and the Lotus Garden residents. And so they tell me that most of the people in the Sangha have had a very strong year of practice. So that's very nice, and I hope that it has been the same for everyone.
I am one of Khandra Rinpoche's senior teachers, and they're called Lopans. I began coming to Rinpoche's retreats from the very beginning, that the annual retreat became annual. And So originally I was coming once a year to Lotus Garden, and then I was coming twice a year, and then I was coming three times a year, and it's a long drive. So last year, actually exactly 1 year ago, last week, I sold my condo in Nova Scotia, and I came to live at Lotus Garden because this is my primary practice and study location.
The five Lopans assist her by running programs throughout the winter when Rinpoche is in India. We run discussion groups here when she does teach. But more than anything else, I think our role is to set an example with our behavior for the other students.
Ongeveer 2 uur rijden van Washington DC werd Kandro's spirituele gemeenschap Lotus Garden opgericht in Virginia. Dit is een boeddhistisch centrum waar kloosterlingen en leken samen kunnen wonen, zelfs met hun partners, om de boeddhistische beoefening volledig in hun leven te integreren.
So there are lots of times when we feel very inspired by teachings. And that inspiration often arises as admiration for the wonderful teachings, feeling very connected to the wisdom and the truth that is being imparted within the teachings, feeling very inspired to inculcating those qualities in one's own life. But at the same time, despite all of these factors, still not fully engaging in the teachings. And fully engaging in the teaching means letting the teachings permeate within oneself to such an extent that you're willing to bring about a full transformation, a full change within one's own self. People like the concept, but may not necessarily want to be the concept. So they might like to know Dharma, Buddhism, but they are a little bit reluctant in being Dharma, letting the Buddhist ideology actually become a part of their own being. So therefore, there is interest, but there is no complete engagement in many respects. And so I think wherever that is there, then there's a little bit of always a gap between the view and the action. So the genuine inward transformation as a human being that should happen may often become neglected. And on the other hand, on the external level, you may be doing everything that a Buddhist actually does. So as long as one is not really examining whether or not one has developed this tendency of discrepancy between the view and action, whether Dharma is something that you're simply doing but not being the Dharma, then I think that's what is the very fertile ground for any kind of spiritual materialism, but the characteristics of spiritual materialism to evolve from.
I think that the thing that struck me the most about Rinpoche was her clarity. You know, it was palatable to me, and in her eyes, in her presence. It got fairly clear to me pretty quickly that I wanted to continue with her. And then in 99, when, you know, career issues and marriage issues came to a head, it was time to do something different. So I asked Rinpoche if I could come to India for 3 months. From that point in time, every year I spent 5 to 9 months in India up until the point that Lotus Garden opened. And then I started to live at Lotus Garden and go to India.
The center is home from which arises Mount Meru, the king of mountains. In the east is Paramahamsa, in the south is Aparangadaniya, in the north is Uttarapuru, Deha, Vidaya, Chama.
That full change and full transformation requires shedding the skin of familiar habitual patterns. of those different ways of thinking, of interpreting things, of how you relate to things, and transforming an impure mind that is suffering from delusion, that is suffering from defilements, into manifesting its very natural true quality of pure mind that is free from the veils of delusions, of defilements. That you're willing to go through the transition and the changes from anger to absolute patience, from desire to absolute selflessness, from ignorance to absolute awareness and wisdom, from jealousy to absolute joyfulness, from arrogance to absolute simplicity and flexibility. So if those, the willingness to really let go of those that the teachings point out as being diseases, as being discursive, as being defilements, as being impure veils, as marks of ignorance, of not knowing the true nature, then that kind of a change would be actual devotion to the path of practice. That would be truly not only being inspired by the teachings, but allowing the teachings to becoming part of your own self.
She set very high standards from the very beginning, and it was the first time that anyone ever looked at me and said, "You, I expect you to achieve enlightenment in one lifetime, and you can do it. Your very nature means that you can do it." And I was tremendously inspired to hear that.
Personally, myself, I feel I have seldom seen someone so much a teacher, born as a teacher. And just recently I was telling them also many stories of, you know, Rinpoche. When we were growing up also, if she learned anything, first thing she'd do was she'd come home and try to teach me that, whether it was driving or a new language or anything. And I was telling them that it's not a way of saying that she was eager to teach, but it seemed so much a part of who she is and still is. It's the very being of a person. And the lack of dichotomy between what is said and the actions, both when that comes together, you know, what one is teaching and what how one acts is the same, then I think that person is a teacher. In a way, she always was because of that characteristic in her. But then when I was 19, she was 25, and we were doing the first big trip around many North American centers and Europe. And we, before leaving that day, that morning, we had gone to get our blessings from Rinpoche, His Holiness. And Chabje Rinpoche, it was back then just the two of us traveling. There was nobody. Now we have all the nuns and everybody. But for many years, we were just two traveling together to all the places. And I remember Rinpoche looked at us and said to us, "You know, you take care of her, you take care of her, and that's how you will be." And I think that's pretty much how it has been. Mm-hmm. You know, you are her
attendant,
and you are her attendant, he said.
Nadat hij zijn vaderland Tibet moest ontvluchten en in ballingschap ging, stichtte minderling Rinpoche dit klooster in de Indiase stad Dehradun. Als opvolger binnen zijn traditie is Khandro belast om samen met de oudere monniken zorg te dragen voor zijn spirituele erfenis en het welzijn van zijn kloostergemeenschap. Dit omvat ook de opleiding van een nieuwe generatie monniken en nonnen.
January, February.
February.
September nala kikin October. November.
November
suyere. September chuko. Okay. Chito sumbala. Abo birthday wala cake to. Shetam cake sa samuthum.
De boeddhistische leer werd in Tibet eeuwenlang doorgegeven door traditielijnhouders. Meestal in de vorm van lama's of tulkus. Die reïncarneerden van het ene leven naar het volgende. De minderlinglijn is ongebruikelijk omdat het een familielijn is die doorgegeven wordt aan zoon of dochter. Er zijn slechts twee zulke familielijnen in de wereld van het Tibetaanse boeddhisme. Deze familielijn is ook bekend om zijn vrouwelijke leraren, Jetsunma genoemd. Dit zijn de lijnhouders hier in de Descent from Heaven stupa. Khanro Rinpoche werd herkend als een reïncarnatie van Yeshe Tsogyal, de eerste vrouwelijke lijnhouder, geboren in de 8e eeuw. Zij was de opvolger van Guru Rinpoche, die het boeddhisme in Tibet verspreidde. Khanro werd, toen ze 2 jaar oud was, tevens door de 16e Karmapa herkend, als de reïncarnatie van de Dakini van Tsopo.
Since the time of the Daklingba, Mandroling has always emphasized present life's responsibilities, serving the Dharma, learnedness, and their own capacity to work and manifest as a practitioner. Every generation seems to have had very strong jetsunmas or women practitioners and teachers, and that has continued within Mandroling now for 11, 12 generations. So the women who are born, the girls who are born into the family, have been given the title Jetsun. So that's the Jetsunma lineage. I grew up very naughty. I decided not to go to school. I was very stubborn about it. Living at the monastery, it's easy to say, I'm not going to go to school. I'm just going to study my pecha, the texts, and so forth. Then there was some kind of conversation, and my mother felt especially that I needed some strict training. For such an extraordinary teacher and then these two daughters to be there, it has to be an extraordinary mother, I guess. Our mother is one of the very important people who have kept throughout her life, I would like to believe, as much as possible sort of grounded. And any amount of sanity that we both probably have has much to do with our mother, our greatest critic. Our greatest, you know, sort of the one who encouraged us the most.
Guys, the daring kissing is in modern is, you know, education in the color, guy machine education. Dine dangbodeul mochege da kanjeul mochege da baeshe jigu jangna songdo de dine dine gara jeudeun geta mochege kenjeul mochege kenjeul mochege jinjimje dangsyo songso gara dangbodeul mochege da jirin galo bau mallen na samso de mochege kono ya mos romtig lo drone bau len ne yongdo dine ga jije Dita nyama rumuchi gian tema ni sungere rawa, bumo ge chu je tu gres nyama ge tu ni den jumba den loju mangu sungere. Di je tu gres rumuchi ge tu pura 100% sure yore. Di ngara dalen ki chu dusel tan te tra de yore. Di ne ke dan dia pu jus.
Are you proud or happy to have a great grandchild that can be in the Jetsunma lineage?
No, then that can be your what they are you proud and happy for the
game? Pay Mr. Gaggy to the kinds of community in the Jitan Ganga pay up within the juniors. Diggy Dantaya, that me get over your younger son, pay Gaggy to this.
I have begun to realize that I actually have a lot of gratitude for both of them, for the roles that they've played in my life, which is of father and teacher and sister and teacher both. And how it never got confusing. And then, you know, people say, was it ever confusing? And I can perfectly honestly say, no, it was never confusing. Because I think there it lay in their skillfulness in being a father when a father was needed and a teacher when a teacher is needed. And as I grew older, I felt I needed the teacher more than the father, and that seemed to be the more prominent role. And now it seems the same with Rinpoche also, that when I was little, there was a lot of sisterly things. And, you know, we used to share the same room until we were teenagers.
The first time I met Khandro Rinpoche was during the time of big initiations that Tengu Khyentse Rinpoche was giving in Mendulang Monastery. I think it was 79 or 80. She was a young girl, and Kandula and Jitsuna both were going to school at that time. But then their father, Mendulang Rinpoche, wanted them to receive the empowerments, so they, I think, took a break and they were receiving empowerments as well. And so we were all receiving empowerments together. One thing I think that, as I recall back, Rinpoche was very, as she is now, very present and as well as also very focused in the empowerments. I think we have a lot of tukus there, and I think during the break and also during the initiation, sometimes we could all get quite wild, but Rinpoche stayed very calm. The Tibetan culture is a male-dominated society. So maybe perhaps the conditions didn't arise as much as for females to become teachers, even though there were many great female practitioners and teach widely in comparison to men. Now, I hope that that will change. Now, in the general, if you look in the West, there's a lot more female Dharma practitioners. And I think it is really very nice to have someone like a Khandro Rinpoche to look up to and have as a role model, and especially also she's so personable, and she's also very up to date, as well as also guide the students in the traditional path of the Dharma to lead them on the Hinayana and Mahayana and particularly Vajrayana path to a state of enlightenment.
Jetsunla is in a very, I think, unique situation. I have it a lot more easier because one cannot really understand what it is like to be a woman and to be born in a family that has sort of been known throughout Tibetan Buddhism as being very crucial or very important, and also the lineage continues with the family. So it is, you know, very, very common for people to categorize you into a certain way. So once people have figured you out, or oh, you're a nun, okay, or oh, you're a monk, here, okay, then so you're going to teach, so you are there, or oh, you're not going to teach, you're there. So somehow people seem to think that if they have you placed in a box, and that has a label on it, then everyone seems to be quite satisfied. We both grew up challenging that. And so, sort of, will they do this? Won't they do this? Will they go there? Won't they go there? Will they remain there? Will they remain there? Will they revolt? Won't they revolt? The Dharmashri group primarily is more preservation of the teachings here on the land. So all the teachings that are given here in Lotus Garden by teachers, not just Rinpoche, but all the visiting teachers, recording of those teachings, and also collecting all of Rinpoche's, Jizun Khandro Rinpoche's teachings from across the world, also the ones that she taught in the past, and archiving them and cataloging them. And there's the internet and the websites to maintain. Dharmashri is actually the heart, more than the buildings and the infrastructure. And of course, those are all very important and take a lot of work. But the actual heart and the beating of the heart is Dharmashri. So that's actually the sacred lineage itself being held. So I think Jatsuna being responsible for that is a huge, huge undertaking. Sangha members, especially, who have the opportunity to receiving teachings in depth and going more deeply into seeing the words of the Buddhas and being able to understand what the Buddha's teachings actually are very lucky, are very fortunate, and that fortunate circumstance must arise as awareness of responsibility, bringing about the actual transformation of the human being from a mundane samsaric member of samsara into embodying the enlightened qualities of the bodhisattvas within one's own lifetime. Such a power is not possible by engaging in Buddhist teachings in the way that is very common today, and that is attraction to the flowery languages and attraction to all the nice things that are being said. If we were to say, silence is kindness, it's a very sweet-sounding phrase, and one can make an intelligent sort of a presentation on how silence is kindness or kindness is silence. And these are all good, but this is what we usually call feel-good Buddhism, because such an sort of a gentle approach may not always have the power of eradicating lifetimes and lifetimes of neurosis, of defilements, of delusion. That's like caffeine. That's like chocolate. That's like any kind of pills that you take to sort of lift you up momentarily or temporarily.
De beoefening van Dharma brengt een gevoel van innerlijke ontwapening teweeg. Welk voordeel biedt dat? Niet alleen voor onszelf, maar ook voor de noden van de wereld.
What is your definition of peace?
Contentment. Contentment not as a sort of in a fabricated way of just thinking that you have sacrificed something, but of finding genuine sense of peace, equanimity within one's own self. And I think that comes when one is able to have a much more vaster perspective of things and your relationship to things. When the thought process of a human being becomes very linear and you begin to get into the habit of always letting the linear view exaggerate a situation, then it's possible most oftentimes that you lose contentment and you're unable to then go with the natural rhythm of things with a much more openness in accepting things as they evolve. And you begin to create more and more resistance, or you increase your expectations. So that, I think, creates an imbalance in mind. And when that kind of an imbalance brings agitation, then the agitation breeds apprehension and suspicion, and it spoils one's relationship to everything. So when one trains, or one at least tries to train in cultivating such kind of a sense of contentment, And that peacefulness, I think, can reach out to everything that you're relating to.
The particular job that I do is support a national network of advocates who go to their state legislature and fight for children to have health care, for have quality education, to make sure they're safe in their homes and community, and that their families are economically secure. So just last week, because of the people that we fund, I was in Washington, D.C. with 370 of the top children's advocates in America, and we went to the White House and we talked with President Obama's top officials. And so the place that I found was very rich was using the privilege and capacity I have to work for the benefit of others. Because when you're lobbying, you can affect millions of children. If you get a law passed, you can help millions of children.
I'm a judge. And I've been a judge for almost 16 years. When I got to be a judge, there were people who were surprised that when I would be sentencing somebody who had committed a murder, that I would relate to the person very much as a human being. And if the person allowed, that there would be a touching that would actually take place in a conversation that would take place. At the same time, I could give a very long sentence. I mean, I've sentenced people to jail for life plus 20 years, which in our American system is probably much too much time. But I've said to them, you still have choices. You still have to have choices about what you do and how your life takes place. And there have been times when I've communicated that to people and they've talked back to me and they've understood that they still have choices and that the sentence is still clearly there, but the sentence is not condemnation, that there's a difference between those.
The question that I ask you, why are you a Buddhist? And after becoming a Buddhist, what do you hope to actually get from this? Why are you doing? Why are you listening to the teachings? And after listening to the teachings, what are you going to do about them? And so all these books that you are reading, why are you reading them? And then after reading them, what are you going to do about it? And all these practices that you are loading yourself up with, and that's all very nice, but then what are you going to do with them? Are you going to create a museum? Are you going to create a library? Are you going to archive this? Are you going to be an archaeologist kind of a person, digging up Buddhist teachings and things like that? What are you exactly going to do with these teachings? The whole purpose of engaging in the path of the Buddhist teachings is to realize the one very important factor, and that is the contrast between your true potential and the present situation. The present situation where the mind is obscured, where the mind is covered in defilements. Are you able to actually see how much of your own true natural nature is not able to manifest because it stumbles, it becomes blocked, it becomes obstructed by hope, by fear, by passion, by aggression, by ignorance, by jealousy, by all shades of many different habitual patterns? If you have desire, selfishness, greed, craving, grasping, attachment, and because of that, how much pain, how much suffering can evolve? Because of ignorance, how much we can create our own sufferings? Because of jealousy, because of arrogance, you see how much suffering arises in oneself and in the environment that we create. And there has to be a strong distaste for it, a strong wish to uprooting this. Therefore, here the right attitude, as the teachings say, is one must see oneself as a patient who is suffering from the diseases of the five root poisons.
Tibetaanse meesters met hun rotsvaste geloof in de wezenlijke goedheid van de menselijke natuur zijn zeer verbaasd te ontdekken dat westerlingen vaak geplaagd worden door zelftwijfel en schuldgevoel.
Low self-esteem or lacking in confidence would be is where you allow your awareness to be more sort of moved towards what is it that you do not have. When the guilt sets in, then the low self-esteem or the lacking in confidence doesn't see a way out. And you think discovering the negativity is itself enough. Whereas from the Buddhist perspective, one would say that discovery of the defilement is no extraordinary feat. It's there. As long as we're in the samsara, we all have these defilements. But what is important is to know that you don't need to stay there. You don't need to dwell there. There is the much more positive view, positive nature that is not in need of retaining the defilements.
One has these notions of controlling or formulating or views of how the world should operate with respect to one's children, at least I did, and tried to impose them. And it doesn't work. And I think the practice has allowed me to permit my children to teach me that if I let them be who they are, that they shine, and that they point away from me. And it lets me see their perfection just as they are, without all my coverings. And without all my expectations and loaded up stuff being put on. And that's an ongoing practice, because I still have fears with respect to them. And my mind can go spinning and saying this and this and this is going to happen. But I found that if I don't act on those fears, that if I just let those fears know that that's me and that has nothing to do with them, that everything is better than fine. About a year ago, when I was really worried about my son, and I was just so afraid, and just could feel myself spinning. I mean, you know, she called me up at work from India to talk to me. And just the fact that that happened by itself was enough to, I mean, that's enough to stop one's mind. It allows me to trust that I don't have to try to fix things. And also then to see that the pain is not what I thought it was. It's both more and less intense than I thought it was. But at the same time, there's tons more space around it.
Friendly.
the culture that we are now in within the world is so much based upon the emphasis of self, individual self. You think about your own. You think about what you like. Your own feelings are the most important. So there's so much of a dominance about keeping your own feelings and your own experiences and expectations as being the most important thing. So children are taught, you are the best, you are the most important, you are the center of the universe. So when the whole language with which we bring up our children is based upon the individual imposing upon everything else, then yes, it becomes a very rigid mind. It becomes a mind so full of self that that itself cannot actually have a pervasive or a flexible attitude. And so the stubbornness and the resistance and then the sort of the attitude of having to get it, or if you do not get it, then the apprehension of that bringing about what is common today, depression, dissatisfaction in one's own self. And in many ways, when you feel that you are not living up to that hope that you have to your own self, there's so much a sense of failure that breeds even greater mental turmoil for many people, and the young people suffer from that. And so I think that kind of a tendency in the human mind has alienated the individual from everyone else. And therefore the sort of the sincerity with which one human being can relate to another human being with a simple thought, just as I want happiness, everybody wants happiness. Just as I don't want suffering, nobody else wants suffering. Even that very simple logic, which is, should be very apparent to a human mind, which is supposed to be very, very intelligent, sometimes that very simple understanding escapes our awareness completely. You could be kind, and yet what are the obstructing factors that do not allow you to simply be kind? You could be selfless, and what are those obstructing factors that obstruct you from being selfless? You could be simple, without wants, without hopes, without fears, and yet what are those impediments that do not allow this simplicity, despite the fact that it is your wish to manifest without obstacles, without challenges?
I started the career in the fashion business when I was about 17, 18. And, you know, there was a tremendous amount of pressure. I was a model, and I moved to Milan when I was 18. And first I moved to LA before that. And the life of a model, it's quite hard. It's actually there's a lot of pressure. It's very competitive. And the schedule is very unrelenting. You don't really sleep in your own bed for more than maybe two nights in a row. But as a whole, the modeling business and just being in that world of kind of insanity, actually, to tell you the truth, made my already somewhat fragile state of mind, or what I felt was my fragile state of mind, felt much more fragile. So meeting the Dharma, well, first meeting my teacher, I would say, gave me a sense that there was some like lifeline. And when I met Rinpoche, he started to answer my questions. And I feel that same sense of kinship with Khandra Rinpoche 100% too. I definitely consider one of my teachers.
I think she's very bubbly and jolly. And if you have spent some time in the house, you would actually see that. She's always laughing. You know, there's an echo of laughter throughout the house for the whole day. And then that is a little bit of an infectious, so all the students also are very happy and always laughing.
What if the blessings run out before we get there?
I can guarantee you that there will be no shortage of blessings.
Khandra Rinpoche reist naar vele westerse landen, waar mensen zoals wij, die gezinnen hebben en midden in het leven staan, ook behoefte hebben aan personencontact met authentieke boeddhistische meesters. Afgezien van het academisch inzicht is de leerling-leraarrelatie van essentieel belang. Kando geeft daarom ook regelmatig les in stadcentra, zoals deze hier in Berlijn.
Buddha's coming and going is also happening within the sphere of your own mind.
Das Erscheinen und das Vergehen der Buddhas geschieht auch alles nur in der Sphäre seines eigenen Daseins.
A bald woman saying something is also happening within the sphere of your own mind.
Eine Dame ohne viele Haare, die irgendwas sagt, auch das geschieht in der Sphäre unseres eigenen Geistes.
And the interpreter is also happening within your own mind.
How did Dharma change your life, personal?
First big change it made was I was so angry about women's issues. I was just so angry all the time. And I was always struggling to try to keep it under wraps because women are not supposed to be angry, we know. And especially in the late 60s, early 70s, it was like the kiss of death for a professional woman to express any anger. So I tried very hard to keep it so that people couldn't tell. And then after I started meditating, it took about a couple of years, but it really changed my anger drastically. Just began to see that angry expressions of my frustration about gender weren't doing anything to help the situation at all. They were just polarizing the situation. And I learned pretty quickly how to express the insight that I had without a lot of anger and aggression. And suddenly people were listening to me. It was quite magical.
Last breath, last, last, last breath. Last, last breath. Last, last breath. Last time, the last time, the 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 time, last time, last time, last time, last time, the time, the time, the time, the time.
It feels that through the spiritual practice, the greatest thing has been just being less so ruffled by things, not so sensitive, and not, I wouldn't say insensitive, but just not so easily disturbed. The calm, the peacefulness, the harmony that sometimes I'm able to achieve, even when unpleasant things happen, when life, you know, sometimes something goes wrong. But feeling that that is not so end of the world, catastrophic, and being able to then calm your mind, I think that that I have appreciated that. There's all the other tremendous benefits of practice, you know, but on a personal level, on a day-to-day as a human being, I really appreciate that, sense of contentment that I hope grows as one grows older also.
Now you have given birth to a young baby girl. That means that the Jetsunma lineage will continue.
Well, it is certainly interesting to have a baby girl now. And we all hope that she continues with the Jetsunma activities, follows in the footsteps of her aunt and great aunts and all the great female teachers. And seriously speaking, I do think that this time today and all times before and the times that will come after will always need female teachers to... it's not just enough, I feel personally also, that you are told that it's the same, you know, men and women can do just as much. It's certainly beneficial when teachers speak of that. But it is entirely a different thing to have an example of that, a living example of that. There's also the need for Western students to begin to understand the Dharma and practice the Dharma in such a way that maybe in the next few years or a decade or so, they can continue to actually impart the teachings with less and less reliance upon Easterners and be able to actually, if trained in the same way, continue. And I think that's the only actual way fullness of the Westernization of Buddhism can happen. You know, otherwise people tend to talk about Westernization of Buddhism, but there is a tendency to be dependent upon the Tibetan teachers. And then the Tibetan teachers, of course, with all their enlightened qualities of wisdom, are doing so much for the benefit of others. But if that dependency on the Easterners continue to remain, then the West will tend to only become students for generations. And that's, I don't think, really bringing the completeness of Westernization of Buddhism. So for that to actually happen, the Western practitioners will have to manifest more experience and in-depth understanding of the Dharma.
In Tibetaanse ceremonies worden uitgebreide rituelen met kostbare reliquieën gehouden. Niet puur als religieus systeem of geloof, maar als een manier om de geest te trainen en de wereldvrede te bevorderen. In stap naar boederschap en naar de ontdekking van de inherente volmaaktheid van de menselijke natuur.
When you do a mahasadhana, a vajrayana practice such as this, and when you do it with the right intentions, it is supposed to benefit all sentient beings in that it passes a tremendous amount of good thoughts and good benefit to, and in the text it's said it helps to avert diseases, wars, famines, and all those things. And that is the general benefit, we would say. But on the other hand, I think it also really helps in creating a sense of container. It's a real practice. Everybody who enters the Drupchen or comes in contact with it really feels the power of the blessings and benefits in the way that there is a small sort of transformation. Let's say just a person passes by and sees the Drupchen happening and has one good thought, you know, one moment of silence, one moment of real true introspection. And that even is a great benefit because that grows from that one thought, something good will come of that.
as it is in today's world, spirituality, as more widespread as it is becoming, also is very intertwined with many people becoming very much more apprehensive about any systemized religion. So there's a lot of hesitancy. I know many young friends, as well as my own many young relatives, who are very apprehensive about being caught in a religion. Yes, there is, if one chooses to, a very systematic approach to Buddhism. But on the other hand, what Buddhist teachings are teaching is something that is much more to do with humanness, of who we are as human beings and the responsibilities that we have as human beings. And the recognition of that is absolutely important for Buddhists too. Not only for non-Buddhists, but for Buddhists too.
All right, bye-bye.
Wilt u naar aanleiding van deze uitzending reageren of een gratis programmagids bestellen? Bezoek dan onze website boeddhistischeomroep.nl. DVD's van onze programma's kunt u bestellen op 010 411 3977.